Please stand. In the name of... I'm sorry. You're right. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Hear the good news. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives you all your sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please stand. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia. Lord be with you. Let us pray. O Lord our God, arrange the course of this world that peace may come, and your tranquil church rejoice through greater service. Grant this, we pray, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. He lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
The first reading is from the book of Exodus, the 19th chapter. They had journeyed from Rephidim, entered the wilderness of Sinai, and camped in the wilderness. Israel camped there in front of the mountain. Then Moses went up to God. The Lord called to him from the mountain, saying, "Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob, and tell the Israelites, you have seen what I did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now therefore, if you obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession out of all the peoples. Indeed, the whole earth is mine, but you shall be for me a priestly kingdom and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the Israelites." So Moses came, summoned the elders of the people, and set before them all these words that the Lord had commanded him. The people all answered as one, "Everything that the Lord has spoken, we will do." Here ends the reading. Let us read Psalm 100 responsively. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth.
Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing.
Know that the Lord is God. It is he that made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture.
Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name.
For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations.
Thank you.
The second lesson is from the book of Romans, the 5th chapter. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we were still were sinners, Christ died for us. Here ends the reading.
Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 9th chapter. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits, to cast them out, and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, his brother Andrew, James, son of Zebedee, his brother John, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus, Bartholomew, Simon the Cyrenian, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 sent out with the following instructions. Go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but rather go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And as you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment. Take no gold or silver or copper in your belts, no bag for your journey, or two tunics, or sandals, or a staff. For laborers deserve their food. Whatever town or village you enter, find out who in it is worthy and stay there until you leave. As you enter the house, greet it. If the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to it. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet as you leave that house or town. Truly, I tell you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than for that town. See, I am sending you out like sheep in the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpent and innocent as doves. Beware of them, for they will hand you over to councils and flog you in their synagogues. And you will be dragged before governors and kings because of me, as a testimony to them and the Gentiles. When they hand you over, do not worry how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given to you at that time. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother will betray brother to death, and a father his child, and children will rise up against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all because of my name. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. When they persecute you in one town, flee to the next, for I tell you, you will not have gone through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. The Gospel of the Lord.
Please be seated. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Right now we're about halfway through the church year. Not everyone here is a Lutheran perhaps, but we Lutherans start a church year every December. And the first half of the year we talk about the life of Jesus, and then we come to Pentecost. And then the second half of the year we focus on the life of the church. So halfway through the year, the question is put to us, will we continue on the same path or will we choose another path? In the Jewish tradition, Pentecost, the day that we remember the Holy Spirit coming down on the disciples, is the day when they remember God's giving of the Ten Commandments on Sinai. Now you might remember that story. Sinai was, you might say, a turning point. God had sent Moses down to Egypt, and through 10 plagues, God had freed the people of Israel from slavery. Then God had taken them through the Red Sea, freeing them from the power of Pharaoh's army. God led them in the wilderness with a pillar of cloud and fire, and when there wasn't enough food, God gave them manna from heaven. And there, when there wasn't enough water, God gave them water from a rock. Then they come to Mount Sinai, and God gives them the law. And that's when Moses says those words that we heard this morning. Or actually, God says to Moses, "You have seen what I did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, therefore, if you obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession out of all the peoples. Indeed, the whole earth is mine, but you shall be for me a priestly kingdom and a holy nation." That's what God said to Moses. In other words, I have brought you this far. You have seen what I've done for you. But now you must decide whether you're going to continue to follow me or not. There is a spiritual written in the 1950s, I believe, by Albert Goodson that summarizes that thought very well. I wish I could sing it, but I can't sing it. And I didn't think about it in time to ask Brad to sing it, so I'm just going to have to say the words. We've come this far by faith, leaning on the Lord, trusting in his holy word. He never failed us yet. Oh, we can't turn back. We've come this far by faith. Don't be discouraged with trouble in your life. He'll bear your burdens and move all discord and strife. Just remember the good things he has done, things that seemed impossible. Oh, praise him, for the victories he has won. We've come this far by faith, leaning on the Lord, trusting in his holy word. He's never failed us yet. Oh, we can't turn back. We've come this far by faith. That's a good question for us as Christians. We've come this far by faith, all of us here. Some of us have come a little way. Some of us have come about halfway. Some of us have gone beyond halfway. Some of us might be near the end of the journey. We've come this far by faith, but where are we going to go from here? So as we are halfway through the church here, that's a good question for us, but it's also a question for all of us in our lives. We have come this far by faith. We have seen what God can do. We remember all the things he's done in the past, but are we going to continue to follow him by faith or not? I've been talking for the last few weeks about the time we are in our country. Theologian Paul Tillich called it a Kairos moment. A Kairos moment is when decisions need to be made, when choices need to be made. There's regular time called Kronos, but in those Kairos moments, everything hangs in the balance. We know that we are seeing changes, at least for me, changes I haven't seen in my whole lifetime. And the future is uncertain. So the question for us today is, where are we going to go from here? Like the people of Israel at Mount Sinai, we have a question. Who are we going to follow now? And as I said last week, I say again, there are many people saying, I know the way forward. I know the way forward. I know the way forward. This is a turning point, and we have to decide who we are going to follow from now on. But for Christians, there's only one choice. We will continue to follow Christ and serve him. He has led us this far by faith, and so we will continue to follow him and listen to him. What will that mean for us? Well, one of the keys is again found in the text. God says to Moses, that the people of Israel will be a royal priesthood, a holy nation. Now, what does a priest do? A priest is an intercessor between God and the people. The priest speaks for God and speaks God's word, and then the priest intercedes for all the people to God. What did it mean then for Israel to be a holy nation? It meant that Israel was not chosen by God just for its own sake. God didn't say to Israel, the rest of this world is going to hell, but I'm going to save that little group of you and let the rest of them go. But instead, God said to Israel, you're going to be a holy nation. You're going to be a priestly nation, which means you as a nation are going to speak God's word to the whole world. You are going to proclaim God's word to the whole world. You are also going to intercede for the whole world to God. That is your calling. Theologian N.T. Wright says that that was one of the major indictments that Jesus brought about to the religious leaders of his day. They thought that their calling was to be a tiny remnant and to let the rest of the world go. But Jesus said, no, your calling has been to be a light to the nations, a city on a hill. Let your light so shine before others that they see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. That was the calling of Israel. But instead, the religious leaders were not only hiding the light of God from the nations, they were hiding it from the rest of the Jewish people. Tax collectors and prostitutes and sinners and shepherds who couldn't go to synagogue, all of the unholy people, they were hiding that light from them too. And they were keeping that light only for themselves. Jesus says, that's not what God called you to do. He called you to let his light shine for the rest of God's people and then for even all of the nations in the world. That's our calling as Christians as well. As we go forward from this point, following Christ in faith, our mission is to be a light to the nations. God hasn't looked at us and said, I'm going to save you. The rest of the ship is sinking. But instead, God says, I have called you to be a light to the nations. Now, the only way to be a light to the nations is to follow Christ in faith. If we follow Christ in faith, we will be a light to the nations. So we are at a turning point as a country. The question for us gathered here today is, are we going to continue to follow Christ by faith, wherever that leads us, and let our faith in him be the light for our nation and for the world? Or have we decided we're going to walk another path? At Mount Sinai, some people said, let's go back to Egypt. Others said, let's head over there and go to Midian, or let's go over there. The choice is there for us too. We've come this far by faith. We know what God has done and what he can do. The question is, will we continue to follow him? And by following him in faith, letting our light shine for the whole world to see. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Please stand. Let us sing sermon hymn number 439. What a friend we have in Jesus.
Our Savior was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the church and for the world, saying, hear our prayer. For the peace of the whole world, and for the well-being and unity of the people of God, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For Elizabeth and Pedro, our bishops, for all the pastors and people of the Florida Bahamas Synod and this congregation, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all those who proclaim the gospel at home and abroad, and for all who teach and disciple others, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For our brothers and sisters in Christ who are persecuted for their faith, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For our nation, for those in authority, and for all in public service, especially police officers, firefighters, doctors and nurses, and members of our armed services. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all those who are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all those who have departed this life in the certain hope of the resurrection, let us give thanks to God. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Lord, especially we pray for you at this time, for the President of the United States and the Governor of the State of Florida, for the Senate and the Congress and all who make our laws. We pray also for those on our prayer list, those who are sick or hospitalized. We pray for missionaries Kristen Engstrom, Bishop Pierre Lenungu, International Health Partners. And God, finally, we remember our sister, Carol Plate, today. We pray for Robert and the rest of their family as they mourn her loss, that in the midst of their grief, they would be comforted with the certain hope of the resurrection. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We give you thanks, Father, through Jesus Christ, your beloved Son, whom you sent to this end of the ages to save and redeem us and to proclaim to us your will. He is your word, inseparable from you. Through him you created all things, and in him you take delight. He is your word, sent from heaven to a virgin's womb. He there took on our nature and our lot and was shown forth as your Son, born of the Holy Spirit and of the Virgin Mary. It is he, our Lord Jesus, who fulfilled all your will and won for you a holy people. He stretched out his hands in suffering in order to free from suffering those who trust you. It is he who handed over to a death he freely accepted in order to destroy death, to break the bonds of the evil one, to crush hell underfoot, to give light to the righteous, to establish his covenant, and to show forth the resurrection. Taking bread and giving thanks to you, said, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering then his death and resurrection, we take this bread and cup, giving you thanks that you have made us worthy to stand before you and serve you as your priestly people. Send your Spirit upon these gifts of your church. Gather into one all who share this bread and wine. Fill us with your Holy Spirit to establish our faith in truth, that we may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ, through whom all glory and honor are yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, both now and forever. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
This prayer with me together. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. Please come forward.
Thank you.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen. Let us pray. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of those whom you have fed with one heavenly food. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.